So I've been working with our local refugee population since 2010. In Wilmington, most of our refugees are from the Democratic Republic of Congo, and also from Burundi, Rwanda, and Ethiopia. The Democratic Republic of Congo is a country rich in resources, yet fraught with conflict and violence. As the second largest country in Africa by land area, and the fourth largest country by population, the DRC is currently experiencing the largest displacement crisis in Africa. Many of its people have not seen peace in more than 20 years. Many people from Burundi and Rwanda have also fled to refugee camps in Tanzania, namely the Nyarugusu refugee camp. Unfortunately, the Burundis are being highly discriminated against in this refugee camp, and they're currently trying to kick them out and to send them back to their homelands, but their home country is still distraught with war and violence. Upon resettlement in the United States, the job of a resettlement support center is to provide housing for refugees upon arrival and to meet them at the airport. And then we also help them with employment, case management, healthcare, cultural orientation, and education. Some of the biggest challenges that refugees face when they resettle are usually language barriers, access to good paying jobs, and affordable housing. Also, many of the children that are resettling would benefit with assistance with academic tutoring and school support, communicating with teachers and staying on top of their responsibilities. Ever since the hurricane, a group of dedicated volunteers to local refugees, including myself and Jocelyn Bean from Global Artisans, Julie Bordeaux, Amanda Boomershein, and Ndaba Olivier, have been committed to helping provide long-term services for refugees in Wilmington. Whether it's essential case management support for housing and employment, or enrichment activities through entrepreneur and homeowner opportunities, Global Connections has established to provide ongoing long-term support for local refugees. Our board of directors is composed of more than 50% refugees in Wilmington, and we're excited to see their successes in the coming years. Given opportunity, newcomers become significant contributors to our society, sharing linguistic and cultural assets, as well as innovative ideas, entrepreneurial skills, and drive, all of which make our community stronger. For more information, or if you have any questions about refugee resettlement, please come visit us at our table after our presentations today. Or you can also find us online at globalrefugeeconnections.org, and we're on Facebook and Instagram. And also, please talk with us or find Global Artisans on Etsy. They also do the Waterline Brewery Markets on Tuesday nights, and she sells handmade items of relatives from local refugees in Wilmington that still live in the refugee camp in Nyarugusu. So all of the sales, profits from those sales go 100% directly back into the families living in the refugee camp. And thank you very much. Lawrence Pagasa is from the Democratic Republic of Congo, and he's going to share his experiences now resettling as a refugee in Wilmington.
Good afternoon. My name is Lawrence because Sabaton's three names, just in Congo, we have three names every time. One, so the first is mine, and the second is my crew. The third is my father or my grandfather. And I'm Ori, now from Congo. I left my home in the Congo in 2010. Escaping violence from a civil war, and I lived in Kenya for almost 7 years before I came here in Wilmington. My family originally came from the Congo and lived in Kenya as a transit country, where just I spent that time before I moved here in the United States in 2016. There was a civil war in our village in the Congo that started in 1996 and it continues today. Till now, just people are killing each other And we expect more deaths, small deaths, because of that civil war. And the last time I visited my home in the Congo was on January 22nd, 2010, when we were attacked at night by a number of militia known as Mai-Mai. Mai-Mai just is a group of another neighboring tribe who attack people during the night. If they do not just be a civil war, they are involved in the political war. And they burned our villages, killed and raped our people, and stole our cattle, destroying our home and destroying our villages. My family was divided that night as we fled by foot to Kenya from 470. I was luckily reunited with two young brothers and my wife. Some people returned to the village, but we didn't go there because we were scared for our safety. Life was very hard, trying to get something to survive in Kenya, but especially when the three children, because I got the third one in Kenya, was born in 2011. It was a very, very difficult to survive. We worked hard for our daily bread, and sometimes we didn't get it. Thanks to the United States government and to the Interfaith Refugee Ministry in Wilmington, who have just enabled us just to come here, to be settled here, we now live together as a family, safe in this country. We did not choose to live in Wilmington. Never, never. Only the United Nations for the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees resettled my family here. Like those, there have been many people in the community here to help care for us. They helped my wife and me find a full-time job within less than 2 months living in Wilmington. Our children also received a good education here. They started just in public school. They now are in the French school, private school, which is something we dreamed of 4 years while fleeing war and looking for safety in Kenya. It feels good to have the opportunity to work for a living and to contribute taxes that we have children in public school. The Refugee Resettlement Program in the United States provides very important humanitarian aid to families like mine from all over the world. The problem now is that I cannot be reunited with my two sons who are still in Uganda refugee camp named Oluchinga. It is just in southern Uganda where they live. They are still now and they are just doing some college studies in Kampala. And because the United States resettled 84,994 refugees in 2016, that it resettled 53,716 refugees in 2017. And only 25,000 refugees in 2018. Look how just the number is decreasing. Just the curve, the growth curve is dropping down. We must petition the White House and our congressmen to request for the number of refugees admissions in the United States to be raised. Refugees bring many economic benefits to the community resettlement. The United States has the history of resettling more refugees than 25,000 a year with success. The United States must strive to become a world leader again in the Mediterranean, heading to Africa and other regions. We are grateful to be in the United States through the Refugee Resettlement Program, and we love being an active member in our community. Thank you very much.
And now Vivene will share her story as a refugee, also from the Democratic Republic of Congo, and moving here from South Africa.
If you ask me about my home, here's what I'll tell you. I'm from a country where the sky is always blue, the sun is always shining, and the clouds are inviting. You see, back home, the streets are hustling and bustling, people talking, laughing, shouting, "Ay, Makai, Makai," jiggling coins in their hand. Back home, the beaches are at my feet, the waves lapping at my toes, the sand crumbling in my hand. Back home, I don't need a painting to remind me of a sunset. The sky is streaked with colors that could never exist in real life. Back home, the mamas sit by construction site, ready to serve ugali and samaki to worn down workers in mismatched dungarees and non-existent construction caps. Back home, the Maasai leaders will welcome you into their bomas. You will learn how to spot crop, how to milk a cow, or even herd goats. Back home, you'll get accustomed to the sound of blaring horns, chewing sugar canes bought right from the streets. Your windows roll down as you wait in the evening traffic. Back home, the babus and the askaris will be playing chess on a board fashioned from pieces of thrown-out boxes and dusty plastic bottle caps on the sidewalk of corner shops, a Serengeti or a Mokola in the palm of their hands. Back home, the children will play with makeshift slingshots, or they will follow you into the trails of the spice stores of Zanzibar, laughing and hiding every time you turn to look back at them. Back home, everyone is family. You will find to have a dada or a kaka, or even a babu or a bibi. Here, the youth respect their elders, greeting them with shikamo or kabari. Back home, the mishkaki is heavenly. Juice is dripping from hot skewers as you sit on wooden benches, eating in the last light of day. Back home, you'll be treated to fire breathers and acrobats. If you find yourself really lucky, you might even see a tribal shimmy or two, though the flames of a campfire on a cold night in the game park. Back home, you'll be excited to wake up at 5 a.m. just so you can see a lioness and her cubs. You'll never forget the vast plains of Ngorongoro or the cheeky monkey in Serengeti, or even the beautiful elephant in Mikumi. Back home, the police will be waiting for you. But not worried. They're not going to arrest you. They just want to know if you're Salama, and if you're really nice, you might want to give them some aid. Back home, it's not all rosy and fun. You'll visit one too many orphanages, and you'll see two too many accidents, three too many thieves, and four too many beggars. But you'll be warned by the humbleness and love of the people. Back home, sometimes the lights don't work, and you don't always get hot water. The tarmac is almost always bumpy, but there's nothing like the experience of cooking in the candlelight. Back home, I grew up spending Sundays climbing in the cars, hosepipe in my hand, and foam in my hair. Back home, the papayas are sweet and ripe, and the pineapples, oh my. The grapes are tangy, and you'll be licking your fingers after every bite. Back home, my summers were spent in the boot of the car, piled high with mattresses and more people than you can count on your fingers. Back home, you'll meet people from all walks of life. You'll be woken by the clangs of the Sunday church bell, and on Friday, the imam will capture you with his call to prayer. If you make it to the temple of Roman Diwali, your eyes will light up in the sculptures of fireworks. Back home, we eat zeddy. At the Michelin star restaurants are the ones that open up the steps of shops that close at 5 p.m. And you'll find Nambos or Natasha, and they'll serve you with a smile even at 2 a.m. Back home, there are markets and the vendors on every road. You'll find a different trinket. But be aware of the pickpockets. You might find you have nothing to pay with after your 10-minute haggling. Back home, you'll be stunned by the clothes, women in bright colored dresses, patterns that are never the same on any shirt. You can take a daladala to the slipway market. If you're feeling brave, catch a boda boda. You'll have the time of your life. Back home, there's a new building every other month. The rents are crazy. The lifts don't always work. But we do have a revolving restaurant with the view of the harbor that is truly worth. Back home, the freshly fried crisps are better than any walkers you'll find in the supermarket shelves. You can get cassava or banana chips, sprinkled with some salt and chili powder, or drizzled in lemon and ketchup. Trust me, it's like a treat. It's a treat like no other. You see, where I come from, life is a different adventure every day. A surprise awaits you with the dawn of each new day. And even though it may not be a walk in the park, it's certainly the best, even when you're in the dark. So, if you ask me about my home, here's what I'll tell you. I'm from Tanzania. How do you do?
Like to close out this portion of the event with a performance by Rhythms in Motion.